Hello and welcome to Eureka Moments. I'm Seema Kumar. Each week on this program, we talk with scientists, innovators, and public health thought leaders who tackle seemingly impossible problems. What drives them? What propels them to be change agents despite all the obstacles? This week, we're talking with four individuals who are working to impact an issue that dates back to our nation's founding: inequity in healthcare. While our country has made many advances to be proud of, the pandemic helped underscore that we're far from where we need to be when it comes to equitable access to treatment. At Johnson & Johnson, we're committed to finding solutions that look beyond our own doors and investing in people and organizations that are bringing innovative solutions to the table. We recently launched the Health Equity Innovation Challenge, which aims to identify potential solutions from local entrepreneurs, innovators, and community-based organizations and provide the support needed to make their ideas a reality. Bold ideas are necessary to change the reality of racial injustice. Innovation can and must be a driving force for leveling the playing field. I recently had the chance to chat with my friend Michelle McMurry-Heath, president of BIO, the Biotechnology Industry Organization, the world's largest science and public advocacy organization. Before she worked with BIO, I was lucky to call Michelle a colleague right here at Johnson & Johnson. She's always been a tireless advocate, and we discussed her focus on broadening access to scientific progress so more patients and diverse backgrounds can benefit from cutting-edge innovation. Hi, Michelle. Welcome. And, you know, I'm going to just dive right in. You have a lot of firsts in your career. You're the first African-American to graduate from Duke Medical Scientist Training Program, where you earned both an MD and a PhD. You are founding director of the Aspen Institute's Health and Science Program. And of course, you know, you are the first African-American CEO of BIO. What excites you most about the science that keeps driving you in all of those different incredible positions?
Well, first of all, Seema, it's such a joy to be with you. Always love an opportunity to chat with you. Thank you for having me. You know, it's easy to stay excited about the science. I can think back to every decade I've been involved in medicine and biomedical research, and every decade has brought these amazing miracles and advances that at the outset of the decade, we didn't think would be possible. Just this last year and a half, we've seen such incredible progress through vaccines like the J&J COVID vaccine, which is just would have thought impossible to even conceive of as, you know, 10 years ago. So it's just remarkable to see that rate of progress. And I would argue there's not another field on the planet that witnesses that type of momentous change so quickly, so often.
I know, it is incredible to watch, right? I mean, we thought that we were doing great before COVID, and then COVID showed us that we can do even better. Now, you've called the distribution of scientific progress the social justice issue of our age. Wow, what a statement. Explain a little bit more about why you believe this and what's the intersection between science and innovation? Mm.
It's so funny. I was reflecting again on that statement just the other day, and I think it's just as true now as when we were talking about it at the outset of the pandemic. Science, as the most powerful tool we have at our disposal, has to be deployed to make the world more just. Science has the capacity to stop global warming. It has the capacity to end hunger. It has the capacity to end human suffering through disease. All of these goals are only within the reach of science, and I would argue more specifically, only within the reach of biotechnology. And so if we're not using that great promise to alleviate disparities, to alleviate the suffering of the least fortunate among us, then we aren't using science to its most just ends. So I think we have to put science on the table when we're talking about how to build a more just society.
That is such a great, great, great philosophy. And science sort of can be the great equalizer in one way. But in another way, science has been, and this is one of my pet peeves, is that it has been a privileged profession, right? It is the privilege of a few who live in the ivory tower and not accessible to all. How do we make a science accessible to all? Any thoughts of that?
No, that sent shivers down my spine as you were saying it, because it is so true. You know, part of using science wisely and justly is being just as passionate about the access to the science. That's access to the scientific knowledge, participation in the scientific pursuits, as well as sharing the fruits of scientific research with as many people as possible. We have to be as passionate about those three aims as we are about our research and development project, as we are about our experiment. All of that is as critically important. But we also have to make sure that the public understands that it is time to storm the towers. If science has been locked up in the academic ivory tower, it is time, way past time, to storm those towers and demand the access to science. Because if you're not making that demand, you are missing the most powerful tool to help you accomplish your goals.
Yeah, and we need science to be more colorful, not just white men in white coats. So
it's very true. You know, the number of people I've trained with over the years who study a disease or study an area because it impacted their family is huge. And that on one hand should be lauded, because it's wonderful to turn that personal story and that passion into the work that you do. But it also means that if we don't have a representative group of scientists really making those choices and pursuing those passions, then we won't have representative science coming out at the end of the day.
Absolutely. Now let's switch gears a little bit to health equity, right? Which is sort of like the outcome of great science can be better health. But then we have disparities in health equity. What's the number one obstacle to having that, you know, achieving that greater equity? And on the opposite end of the spectrum, what do you think is the biggest hope for reaching equity in healthcare?
You know, it's so interesting. Earlier today, I was having a conversation about the sometimes false dichotomy that policymakers make between public health and innovation. You know, they pretend that public health is really the purview of just obtaining more access to healthcare that's available today, without realizing that the most powerful healthcare that we should be talking about is the healthcare that has yet to even be developed or discovered. And so we need to make sure that when we're thinking about public health, we're thinking about the whole spectrum of what science and medicine can deliver to a community. I'm the daughter of a public health nurse and a pediatrician, so I think through that lens so often, and it's critically important in our policy debates that we recognize that, and we have to illustrate that to the general public too, so they know what's at stake.
Absolutely. And so, speaking of the public, I mean, why is advocacy for science so important to both changing the narrative and the outcome for diverse populations and communities of color?
You know, it's so interesting. There have been so much talk about systemic racism over the last year and a half, rightfully so. There is so much to do and so much that yet needs to be done. But we haven't talked about the implicit bias of saying that science only applies to a few. You know, when we say science is only for the wealthy or biomedical breakthroughs are only for the privileged few, that is a way of distracting communities that really are in need of those breakthroughs from even recognizing them as something they should be calling for and demanding. And so we have to fight that scientific misinformation, not just because it will help us have better health outcomes, but because it has been obscured by people who often are speaking from a position of health privilege that can afford to dismiss scientific breakthroughs from communities that really are in desperate need of those breakthroughs.
Absolutely. Now, you spoke a little bit about your family, and you also shared your past family experiences navigating clinical trials and funding uncertainties within the rare disease community, and that has shaped your perspective. I mean, can you share a little bit more about those experiences and what those challenges underscored for you?
Yeah. Well, you know, I think almost all of us in healthcare have a personal story about how we've been touched by illness and how it shapes how we think about the path of that illness leads us on. So my first husband had cystic fibrosis and was, you know, struggling in graduate school with whether or not he should participate in a clinical trial. He decided to participate. Then there was the uncertainty of, am I on the placebo or am I on the real drug in those beginning weeks before you even have a sense of whether or not there's a response. And he happened to be in the active arm of a very important study of one of the first new therapies for cystic fibrosis in decades at that point. And it was life-changing for him. But then we faced the uncertainty at when the trial ended of guaranteeing access to it, or what if the trial was not accepted by FDA and the product did not eventually get on the market. It is such an emotional roller coaster to be involved in a clinical trial. I think we as a society have to recognize that and really express our gratitude to the patients and families that participate and help us get that clarity and that information.
Absolutely. And thanks to all of the people who participated in the various clinical trials, thanks to which we now have, you know, not one, not two, but four COVID vaccines, if not more. So yes, indeed, they, you know, people participating in clinical trials, we owe them a big, big, big thank you. So this series, as we were mentioning, is about Eureka moments, those flashes of genius that lead to breakthroughs. What has been your biggest Eureka moment?
There's been so many. I would say that at the beginning stages of COVID, I was just transitioning into taking the role of at Bio. And it was so amazing to see how our companies were mobilizing. I mean, I had seen a glimpse of it at J&J, which really, you know, pivoted on a dime in part because of its commitment to the credo to really respond to human need as it emerged. But what I got to see from the Bio vantage point was this global response. And many folks don't realize, you know, we spoke about the four COVID vaccines, that there were actually 1,000 research and development programs started by our biotechnology companies around the world, trained at trying to stop or prevent COVID. Over 200 vaccine programs were begun. So we focus a lot, as we rightfully should, on the successes. But we also need to pay a lot of attention to how rare those successes are and how much human capital, thought, emotion, and passion goes into all of the failures and how much we learn from those failures. So I really see us as needing to apply the lens of supporting biomedical research because it's important to our communities and to our world through the lens of supporting both the successful and those informative failures as we go forward.
Absolutely. And, you know, as we mentioned at the top of the program, Johnson & Johnson just launched the Health Equity Innovation Challenge because we're looking for entrepreneurs who have the potential to advance health equity because, you know, communities of color are experiencing this day in and day out. They know what the problems are and they probably know what the solutions are. It's just that they haven't had the access to resources and expertise and capital to make those ideas come alive. So do you believe that fueling more diverse scientists and entrepreneurs from communities of color could be an effective way to address disparities in health? And what can organizations like Bio and Johnson & Johnson do to do more to empower diversity in science?
You're right on. Entrepreneurs are such an important and interesting class of our society. These are really the pioneers. They're, you know, they would have been Christopher Columbus centuries ago. They're the ones that go out in those uncharted waters and really find the leads that help all of us expand and grow. And it's important that they look like the rainbow that our society is. I was on a call earlier today with our the vice chair of our board, Dr. Ted Love, who, you know, was educated at Harvard and Yale, went through the ranks at Genentech and retired, and then was approached by an entrepreneur who wanted to study sickle cell disease. And he came out of retirement. And just this last week, his biotech breakthrough won the Prix Galien Prize for the best biotech breakthrough of the year. And it's a new sickle cell breakthrough. So that's the kind of passion that you see when you expand that seed capital to a wide range of entrepreneurs. that can see things from many different perspectives. It's important.
So thank you, Michelle, for joining us.
Thank you for having me, Seema. And thank you for this important dialogue.
I always enjoy talking with Michelle. She is such an impressive leader, and I admire all that she's doing to be a champion of science. Diverse perspectives are crucial to accelerating progress, and that's why we created the Health Equity Innovation Challenge, to better invest in solutions developed for the community by the community. And we're calling for ideas that will enhance equitable access to care, stimulate diversity in science, advocate for more trustworthy community-based healthcare, and prevent and treat illnesses that disproportionately affect Black and Hispanic communities. The deadline to apply is November 12th, and we want to hear from you. If you have ideas, please submit them at jnj.com/Health Equity Innovation Challenge. My next two guests are entrepreneurs who are working within their communities to build brands while also working to promote and broaden perspectives and access. Keenan Beasley is the founder and CEO of Sunday to Sunday, a hair care line that aims to better serve active lifestyles for Black women. And Tiffany Whitlow is a co-founder and chief development officer of Acclinate, which works to increase diversity in clinical trials. Keenan and Tiffany, welcome.
Thank you for having me, Seema.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for joining us on Eureka Moments. You know, the key to being a successful entrepreneur is finding a need that's not being met. And some of the world's leading scientists and doctors are working to solve some of the biggest challenges in equity, creating equity actually in healthcare. Yet making progress means tackling the issue from many different targets. So, Tiffany, why are community-based solutions a vital part of the picture of the solution?
Because the problems that exist today are the lived experiences of the people within the community. Because these problems are existing within our schools, within our homes, within the barbershops and hair salons. And we need to understand that there's someone in the community who's currently maybe suffering of high blood pressure and doesn't have a healthcare provider, doesn't really have someone to ask certain healthcare questions. There's a mom that's dropping her child off at daycare, and the mom can't afford her prescriptions for her child's albuterol inhaler, right? And so you really have to understand the lived experiences that at which point someone is actually making a healthcare decision. Neither of these people are considering a clinical trial as a treatment option. And so right now we kind of think about clinical trials as a when we want to offer it to you. It needs to be kind of a normalized treatment option and a consideration for people. And we can only really accomplish that by meeting them where they are and understanding their lived experience.
That is such a great insight, because communities are best placed to understand what the problems are and what the solutions could be. Keenan, how did the idea of solutions developed for the community by the community play into your work launching Sunday to Sunday?
Well, I think for me, I mean, I am relentlessly focused on improving quality of life for underserved and underrepresented communities. So, you know, I have a keen sense of, it's almost like a red light that goes off when I see areas where people are not living their life in the most fulfilled way. And when you look at Sunday to Sunday, we had, you know, 40% of Black women weren't working out because of their hair. And yet we know what the health impact has been, right? Through obesity, hypertension, et cetera. A lot of these can be solved with just leading active lifestyles. Well, it was often overlooked that one of the barriers to them living an active lifestyle was their beauty regimen, because of the societal pressures, because of the mental health that goes into having to be well kept, right? And having an appearance publicly. So, you know, as much as I've launched a beauty brand, I've launched a health brand.
That is such a great Eureka moment to actually realize that, you know, some of the health problems related to, you know, blood pressure, obesity, diabetes, et cetera, from not living an active health lifestyle actually comes from actually being worried about your hair. I mean, that's such a Eureka moment. And thank you for jumping on it and creating Sunday to Sunday. Tiffany, Acclinate. Similarly, you know, works to help organizations access and engage communities of color so that research can be more inclusive and reflect the population that it actually serves. I mean, was it difficult as a new business to convince investors on the broader impact of marrying culture and technology to further equity?
Absolutely. That's an understatement. You know, we really went in the room and said, stop, the current process does not work and is not inclusive. And, you know, I tell people all the time, we need to move diversity beyond the buzzword of diversity. People say even they want to diversify their portfolios when they're looking at investing. So in order to really move diversity beyond the buzzword, you have to be inclusive. And that really might mean that you're thinking and working differently. You're contracting and investing differently. And so if we want to argue that the current process might not be set up to be inclusive, we could argue the same thing for the way that people think about investing. And so the same original question you asked, why are the communities so essential? The communities are essential because these problems are the lived experiences. And so therefore the solutions are coming from within the community. And we might not have equal access to funding and opportunities prior to meeting that first investor for our seed round.
Absolutely. And that's why we've launched the Health Equity Innovation Challenge, because we know that, you know, solutions live within communities that are entrepreneurs who want to make progress, but they may not have access to resources and access to mentorship, access to seed capital, access to, you know, a big company resource. And so, I'm glad that, you know, we will have a chance to give innovators this opportunity. Now, Keenan, in addition to creating products that help women of color, you're also the chairman of Venture Noir, a profit, actually a not-for-profit that's focused on bridging the income inequality gap. Can you tell us a little bit more about what you're working to achieve and how you're doing it?
Yeah, I think, you know, again, right, it's very tied into what Sunday to Sunday is. There is a quality of life gap that exists in America. And I think we've confused it sometimes with income because of just our capitalistic structure. So all I'm simply doing is pulling the two worlds together and letting investors, letting the outside world, large corporations understand that there's an opportunity to invest in underserved and diverse communities, not just because it's the right thing to do or there's some sort of societal impact, but there's also an economic impact that is needed. When I've looked at America, I've said the greatest export of America right now is Black culture. It has transcended the world through music, through art, through dance, through ingenuity, through effort, through everything. And yet we haven't capitalized on the wealth. But as a good investor, right, and anybody being a steward of that, we understand that by the time an opportunity is obvious, you're too late as an investor. So I'm just putting a light on these opportunities right now. And we've created opportunities for entrepreneurs where we just had 25 graduates of our cohort to go from idea to first dollar to first million to scale. And what does that look like? What's the right ecosystem of partners for them? Bringing investors into that room so that they can actually interact with these founders that are in different worlds than they are, right? Oftentimes, you know, it's like being at a barbecue. You know, you just need one friend there, right? Somebody to help you with an introduction so you can navigate that picnic, right? That barbecue, that party, that event. Venture Noir serves as that bridge to help people get comfortable in unknown worlds, right? In a place where they haven't been, right? Not a lot of folks invest in Black hair care. Why? Because most VCs are white men. That's not something they're familiar with. It's not that they're racist or things of that nature. They just don't understand, and they more than likely don't know anyone at that barbecue. Venture Noir can really sit at that intersection.
That is so great. And it is all about the network. It is about what you know, and it is about who you know. And so what you're doing is great. Now, you're both entrepreneurs with impressive accomplishments. And on this program, we like to talk about Eureka moments, the spark of inspiration that helped you fuel your ideas that, you know, gave rise to a new business. Can you share one of your Eureka moments? Maybe Tiffany will have you go first.
You know, we've had several Eureka moments, and I want to give kudos to J&J, not because we're sitting on this call, but because, like Keenan said, you really need that champion in the room. And so I appreciate things like this health equity challenge that you have, really understanding that you have to not only meet people where they are, but give them that internal champion, which happens to be a part of the prize package. So I have to throw that out there. My number one Eureka moment as a co-founder is definitely understanding that it is my own lived experience that can really help me solve a problem. And so from being adopted because of the color of my skin, I know that I can go in a room and fight for what I consider to be inclusion in a different manner, because my biological mother kept her four Caucasian children and I was the only one that was given up. That is something that I live through, something that I deal with that can help other people when they're thinking about solving some of these really robust challenges. Which leads me to really understanding that my son being diagnosed with asthma and given albuterol, which unfortunately is less effective in minority groups. However, the most commonly prescribed drug to minority groups is the Eureka moment that really kind of started our whole company and our focus with just saying that number one, it is to educate someone and to meet them where they are. And I would argue that health education is its own disparity. That was really our Eureka moment for our company.
Fabulous. And I'm so glad that Acclinate and you and your company is doing, you know, all of the great work that is needed to actually address those inequities. And Keenan, what about you?
I almost don't want to follow that. Tiffany, that is just beautiful. Like, seriously, thank you for sharing that in your story and bringing your solution to the world. I'm an entrepreneur. And I think similar to you, we're just fans of other entrepreneurs. So I'm a fan of yours, and I appreciate it. But yeah, to answer, I guess on mine, you know, if I have to follow it, mine's even, you know, a bit more funny. You know, if I think about it, I was sitting there and my niece is a 13-year-old swimmer, right? One of the top swimmers in the country. And just being a black girl that, you know, unfortunately now likes boys. And I had to deal with that as the big scary uncle. You know, she came to me actually crying one day because she didn't feel pretty. And it's just not something that you think about as an uncle, as a family member, because she's such an unbelievably talented and just gifted young woman. You know, just an honor roll student, right? A superior athlete, but just a great kid. But to have a fear and be crying because something is upsetting you because of your beauty regimen and the pressure that she's feeling as a young girl, I said, wow, we have to have beauty solutions that are way more inclusive, that prevent women from making these unfortunate compromises between their health, their activities, things that they love, and their beauty regimen, right? Because of these societal pressures. So, you know, for me, that was the Eureka moment where I said, I need to make sweat and activity beautiful. I need to make sure that eating a healthy lifestyle is beautiful. It's not just about coming out of a salon and having something that costs you hundreds of dollars and you can only maintain for a day if you're a black woman in a high humidity area, right? How do we make it where you're beautiful and you feel beautiful 7 days a week from Sunday to Sunday? And that was a Eureka moment. And that was the spark for me as a brand, you know, to make it personal. How can I do something to help out my niece and the women that are in my life that I think are just absolutely incredible?
That is so great. It is wonderful to hear both your stories and, you know, again, underscores the importance of, you know, Eureka moments, insight, whatever you call it, where you see an issue and you see that it's right there under your nose and you can, you know, jump in and solve. And both of you, thank you both for the important conversation, but also for the great work that you're doing to, you know, move things forward and to be great change agents, both of you. So thank you. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you so much.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. And our last guest today couldn't join us live, but I was able to spend a few minutes speaking with Helene Gayle. She is a leader in both healthcare and economic development, and she is focused on learning how the two are closely related. First of all, thank you so much for making the time. Your career, you know, it has just been so impressive. With big Tiffany issues and focus, Tiffany, like HIV/AIDS, and recently you've shifted your work to more closely aligned with issues like poverty, wage inequality, and education for women and girls, something that I am very passionate about. Mm-hmm. So how do these broader social issues tie back to your love of medicine and your work as a physician, as a doctor.
So thank you very much. And it's wonderful to be with you and wonderful to be part of this Eureka moment and this whole effort to address health inequalities. And I guess I would just start from there. You know, part of the reason and a large motivation for me to pursue a career in medicine was because I wanted to be able to have the tools to tackle tough problems, health being so central to people's lives. You know, I thought medicine would give me practical tools to make a contribution to my community and to the nation and the world. But I really realized that if we really want to tackle some of the issues around inequity in health, that looking at that more at a population level was important, because I think we recognize that so much of health is really linked to broader social and economic issues. And so many of the disparities in health that we see are really shaped by the social determinants of health. You know, whether or not you have adequate income to feed your family, whether or not you can have access to fresh and wholesome nutrition. If your water is polluted, if your air is polluted, the health impact is clear. So, you know, the more I thought about the ways in which I could have an impact on some of these health disparities, the more I realized that digging into some of these other issues, what we now call the social determinants of health, was critically important as well.
Absolutely. I mean, and as we say, and as they say, I mean, your zip code has as much of an impact on your health outcomes as your genetic code. And so, and we've spoken a lot on this series about how being an outsider can actually be an advantage in science, meaning looking at science from outside of the scientific lens. How can it help you look at problems, through a different lens, meaning has your background provided you an opportunity to look at some of Chicago's biggest challenges in a new way because you're looking at it with a different lens?
Well, you know, I came to Chicago, new to Chicago when I took my job, new to thinking about these issues of economic inequity at a local level. I'd spent most of my career in public health and globally and nationally. And I think by coming in and having no preconceived notions, it allowed me to listen and learn in perhaps a more unbiased way. And, you know, when I came to Chicago, I took time to talk to communities, talk to others in the field, and really listen and learn, but still to apply a lot of the tools that were familiar to me. You know, how do you diagnose a problem? How do you dig to see what the causes are for an issue? How do you collect the data that's important for bringing people together to understand the problem? And then how do you develop solutions based on that? And also core to that is how do you listen to the communities whose lives you want to have an impact on? And all of those things that, you know, I've learned through my years as a public health professional were very much applicable to the work that we're doing here around economic inequity.
Absolutely. And, you know, you're also very passionate about educating women and girls. So how does better education especially of women and girls, correlate to better healthcare for women and girls around the world?
Well, you know, if you look at the social determinants of health and how they impact health, there's probably two that stand out: income and assets and wealth, and education. And both in this country as well as around the world, it's very clear that education has a direct correlation to one's health outcomes. And in, you know, around the globe, and particularly in a lot of the developing countries that I spent a lot of time working in, girls are disproportionately held out of the education system and don't have access to education. We know that if a girl is educated, she is more likely to marry later, she'll have fewer children, she's more likely to earn an income. And you can create this virtuous cycle just by getting a girl educated. And so, you know, I'm a firm believer in what education can do, not only just because it is the best way to earn a living and have opportunities, but it also has such a huge proven impact on health.
Absolutely. And, you know, COVID-19, of course, has been, I mean, unprecedented, as we all say, biggest public health emergencies of our time. How did issues pertaining to access and health inequities factor into your work, and how will it shape it moving forward?
Well, right before the COVID pandemic hit, we had developed our strategy around closing the racial and ethnic wealth gap in the Chicago region. And clearly, COVID, with its disproportionate impact on communities of color, only highlighted why that was so important. And, you know, as we all know, this is the first time in our lifetime where we have seen a pandemic have this massive impact on our economy in the ways that show the intertwined nature of health and economic well-being. So in some ways, COVID meant that we doubled down on the things that we were doing around the wealth inequality, but also the health inequality. And how do we make sure that people who were disproportionately impacted by COVID were not the ones who were left out as we found solutions to this pandemic, like vaccine and other access to health?
You know, our series is about Eureka moments, the past, the sparks, those, you know, sudden moments of innovation or seeds of ideas or inspiration that can lead to life-changing innovation. What have been some of your Eureka moments in your career, and how has that impacted your work?
Well, you know, some of my Eureka moments have been, and most profound moments have been when I've had the opportunity to be in the field and listen to people who really do have the answers to their own problems, but we don't always give them the tools. And I say, if you listen to communities, you will be able to come up with a lot of the solutions for the challenges that we face. And so I, you know, there are lots of vignettes of being in some of the poorest rural areas in the world and having villagers tell me the things that they needed to be able to solve their own problems.
You know, that is so interesting because, you know, our health equity innovation challenge, as you know, is actually counting on that, because people who have lived in communities of color, people who have personal experience and have actually lived and breathed the challenges of inequities, are the ones who will know, first of all, what the problem is that we need to solve, and second, how to actually solve for it. And so my question for you as it relates to the Health Equity Innovation Challenge is, you know, why is innovation and entrepreneurship at the community level so crucial to addressing both systemic racism and health inequity?
Well, I think it's just critical because, you know, we all have our own experiences, and they're all valid. But if we listen to people who we hope to serve and whose lives we hope to change, those are the voices where we will get a lot of wisdom, a lot of innovation, because, you know, oftentimes people in communities where there are disproportionate health challenges actually have a lot of what is of the ingenuity, a lot of creativity. They have gone through incredible challenges oftentimes with systems that are broken to be able to seek access to care, seek solutions to their own problems. And so we can just reverse engineer a lot of the ways in which people have managed, you know, against great obstacles. I think we will find some real innovations in how we make sure that access to care, but also access to solutions more broadly, are found.
You know, that is so great. And that's why we're so happy that, you know, you're partnering with us on this, because we hope to find some real game-changing innovation, you know, come forward. A question for you is, how do you believe companies, healthcare companies like us, can contribute to closing the health equity gap?
Well, you know, there's so many ways that I think companies can help. You know, companies that make products like J&J, you know, your products are important for, you know, improving the health of people. You have a workforce that has skills that are transferable to communities. You have assets and financial resources that can be useful. So I think, you know, putting all of those things together, and partnering with others. You know, one of the things that I think that is so critical about this is the fact that this is a partnership opportunity. J&J has certain skills and tools, but there are partners in the nonprofit sector or the public sector that complement what J&J does together. So I really believe that our best solutions are when we all use our complementary skills and comparative advantages and put that together in a creative way to solve big problems.
So what gives you hope for the future?
I guess what gives me hope is the fact that companies like Johnson & Johnson and others are joining with governments, the nonprofit sector, philanthropic arena, all coming together, thinking about how can we share what we have to really work together to solve some of these tough challenges. The other thing that gives me hope is the next generation. When I see the generation of young people who are coming along, who are more global in their thinking, who are more committed to changing the world, who are more diverse in many ways, you know, I really have hope that we can make the kind of changes that we want in the future.
That is great. Thank you so much again, Helene, for joining us, and really appreciate your partnership and your advocacy, and hope that we can solve health inequities for the future. Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
I'm so thankful to Helene for that conversation and feel so tremendously hopeful about the trajectory of health equity, knowing that women like her are on the front lines of this battle. There is clearly a tremendous amount of work left to be done to close the gaps in inequity and the gaps in outcomes that we see in our society today. But I know that we can accomplish great things if we build understanding, deepen empathy, and continue to believe that the next goal, the next great breakthrough, is just around the corner. Thank you for joining us on today's episode of Eureka Moments. I hope that today's conversations have left you inspired and with a shared sense of hope. Tune in every week for more stories of innovation and discovery. And if you like what you see and want to hear more stories of hope, don't forget to subscribe below. Thank you.